So in the previous class we have seen timer theory, and now we will see timer programming. So basically we have seen two important registers in timer, TCON register and TMOD register. Now using that registers we will generate a square wave program. So for a square wave, what you need? You need two states, that is zero state and logic one state. So you should maintain that zero state for some duration, and you should go for a transition, and then you should maintain the same one for same duration. If duty cycle is 50%, that is T on time and T off time both are same, then that becomes your square wave. So directly I have given the question here. Write a program to generate a square wave of 1 kilohertz frequency on a display connected to P1.2. Okay, so here you can see P1.2 is a bit, through that bit you are giving the square wave to display. Okay, so we have seen this diagram many times in our timer theory. So if oscillator which is up to 12 megahertz, it will be divided by 12, becomes 1 megahertz. So in our program you can use T0 or T1, but I am preferring T0. Okay, so if you are supplying fixed frequency, then this T0 will act as what? Timer. If you are supplying variable frequency, it will act as counter. Okay, so you just assume that, sir, square wave is a combination of 0 and 1. Okay, 0 maintained for some delay and 1 maintained for some delay. Okay, but you may get an idea that simply if I am giving out 0 and 1 bits continuously, can't I generate a square wave? Yes, you will generate a square wave, but the duration or the delay will be simply 0 or 1 seconds. So how? So you can see the wave in this fashion, simply zeros and ones, zeros and ones, zeros and ones. Okay, so this is not your desired square wave. If you want your desired square wave, it should be in this fashion. So it should be, it start with zero, it should maintain the same state for some duration, and it should show the transition and should maintain logic one for same duration. Okay, now coming to the program directly, he has mentioned 1 kilohertz. 1 kilohertz, inverse of 1 kilohertz time is 1 millisecond. So T on time should be 0.5 millisecond and T off time should be 0.5 millisecond. Okay, you are using T0 here as a timer. Counting frequency, so with what frequency you want to generate the square wave, and internally it is acting as timer means it will also produce delay means by counting. Okay, how you should count, with what speed you need to count, that will be decided by this counting frequency. This counting frequency equal to oscillator frequency by 12. So for different communications we use different oscillators. Okay, 11.092 we may use 12 megahertz. Some other oscillators are also available. For that I have mentioned here F oscillator by 12. Assuming that we are using 12 megahertz frequency, so what the counting frequency becomes 12 by 12, it is 1 megahertz. Now, inverse of 1 megahertz is what? 1 microsecond. That means you are counting one count. To count one, you require 1 microseconds. But what we need to count here, we need to generate 0.5 milliseconds delay here. Okay. Now, the required delay is what? 0.5 milliseconds. So our count is in microseconds. So I'm trying to convert this into microseconds. So it becomes 500 microseconds. That means you need 500 counts to generate to generate this desired delay. You need require 500 counts. Okay. But you need to load the desired count, 500 microseconds count. So how to load the count? We have seen this formula. Okay, count to be loaded is equal to maximum count minus desired count plus 1. Okay, but maximum here, while writing the maximum count, most of the students commit a mistake here. So they will write maximum count as 65536. Okay, that is not maximum count. So in general, we assume 2 power 16 is 65536. That's okay. But you are counting from 0, 0, 1, 2, 3. So what will happen? The final value becomes 65535. Okay. Minus your desired count is what? 500 microseconds plus 1. So you get this value in decimal, convert this decimal into hexadecimal. Okay, now you are ready to write the program. Okay, what is the program, sir? You need to select, you need to start with 0, maintain delay, jump to 1, maintain same delay. Okay, you need to do this thing. And meanwhile, you are generating the delay, means you should have a sub program as delay program. Okay, see here, coming to the program, I have taken the label as main. Okay, first thing is what you need to display your square wave on P1.2, okay, 41.2 bit. So for that, I am writing what clear P1.0, P1.2, that means it becomes 0, and I should maintain that thing for some delay. So for that reason, I am calling a sub program using what? Absolute call. Absolute call delay is your label. Okay, you know the difference between S jump, okay, S jump, A jump, and L jump. Similarly, A call, S call, okay. Call delay. So where is your delay program available? Your delay is available here. So what is happening in this delay? See, move tmod comma hash 01. Okay, you need to understand this thing. So for that, you need to take tmod register. What is tmod register? It contains two timers, timer 1 and timer 0. Internal bits are same for t0 and t1. m0, m1, c by t bar, g. Okay, you have seen these things. I have selected 01. That means I have selected mode 1. So in the previous class, we have seen we have mode 1, mode 0, mode 1, mode 2, and mode 3. What we have seen, mode 1 is used for simple generation of delays. Okay, mode 0 is for what? In bit. Okay, similarly, mode 3 is what? Continuous mode. Okay. So our idea is to generate a delay. Okay, so we should definitely use what? Mode 1. Now we are using timer 0. So for that, I am accessing only these bits. I will put this timer 1 bits as 0. One more thing, we are using this t0 as timer. So c by t bar should be 0. What is the gate? So that is what you are using, external hardware or not. So it is 0 means you are not using any external hardware. Okay. We have taken the example of switch, on and off switch. Okay. I think you remember in the previous class. Now you are loading this thing. That means you are activating t0 as timer in mode 1. Now you need to load these things. What you need to load? You need to load the count FE0CH. Okay, for that I am loading in 8-bit registers TL0 and TH0. Lower byte is loaded in TL0 and higher byte is loaded into TH0. But you see a small difference here. Instead of writing FE, I am writing 0FE. Why? So while converting this thing into opcodes, okay, assembler, while converting this instruction, not comma hash 0FE, if you have mentioned only FE, so the assembler will get confused that this FE is number or a variable. Okay, so if you are mentioning 0 here, it will definitely understand that this is a number. Because you are giving this thing as a count or number, you should mention 0. The count is loaded. Now move tcon comma hash 10. That means you need to start your timer. If you are starting your timer, then it starts counting. Okay, so for that, what is available here? Okay, you have the con register. In that, first part is timer part, second part is what? Interrupt part. You are not interested in interrupts here, so all these 4 bits will remain 0. And one more thing, you are using what? T0. So T1 bits should also be remain 0. Now TR0 bit, TR is what? Timer run bit. That means if you want to start this timer, you should mention this TR0 bit as 1. Okay, and TF0 should remain 0. But what will happen here, after it starts counting, running TR timer run is started, it starts counting, it will count up to the desired value, and then what will happen, automatically TF0 becomes 1. Okay, automatically it will become 1, and when TF0 becomes 1, it interrupts processor, it will go to serve the ISR. By going, it will clear TF0. So we have seen these things in detail. So TF0 and TF1 both are what? Auto cleared. Okay. Now, after completion of this part, what is happening? Now, you have loaded the count, but the timer has start the count and it should generate overflow. So I will continue with this weight label. Jump if not bit, TF not comma weight. So what you are understanding from this jump if not bit means jump if TF not bit is not set. Okay, if it is not set means if it is zero. Jump if not bit means not set. So you will see here TF not, is it one? No, it is zero. Then it will jump to this weight. So once again it will verify after 10 counts. It will verify. It will jump to weight. Okay, once again it will check. It will verify. So finally, when our count, desired count has reached, what will happen? Timer 0 will overflow. How it will overflow? Indicating by setting this TF not bit 1. So if this bit becomes 1, what will happen, sir? Jump if not bit is set to, if it is not set, that means 0, it will jump to it. Not set, what will happen? It is set, means it will continue with next instruction. And clear TR not, here TR not is what? Timer run bit, initially we have set, now we are resetting this. Okay, now clear TF not, that means it has set, and once again we are resetting this. So there is a reason why you are mentioning these two things. Even if you don't write these two instructions, clear TR not and clear TF not, okay, nothing will happen. Okay, you are still, you will get the program, but when next time when you are writing the next program, it will take these values, TF not as 1 and TR not as 1. So to avoid that confusion, we are clearing these bits. So it will, after getting the desired values, you are clearing this. Okay, now return means you will jump to main program. Once again, what will happen? Okay, then you will go with this set P1.2. Set P1.2 means what? You will set the value and you are interested on time. So you are going with logic 1. So A call, once again it will jump to this particular delay. Same thing will happen. Okay, after overflowing, you will clear these bits and once again you will jump to this. Okay, so it will continue in this fashion. So you will generate a square wave. Okay, so the standard, so what I have explained is a standard procedure to generate a square wave. So what is the standard, sir? First thing, that you need to definitely select a mode. You have done this using TMOD register. You need to load count. You have done using TL0 and TH0. And third thing is that you need to start the timer. So selected, you have selected T0 in our program. So you have started, okay, using TCON register. Now you have to wait. So this is your standard procedure, standard method of doing or generating a square wave. Okay. See, here we have followed the same thing, but to initialize TL0 and TH0 with some count, we need to go with this procedure. Okay. So we need to see what clock frequency is mentioned in the question. So here he has mentioned 1 kilohertz. So for that 1 kilohertz, I will convert into time 1 millisecond. It becomes 0.5 and 0.5. Okay. So for that, we need to see what is oscillator frequency divided by 12. Luckily, we got 12. Sometimes you get 11.05. That means you get some numbers. You won't get a round figure. So that creates some problems. That means after dividing, you should convert that into round figure and get the counts. Okay. So here 12 megahertz by 12, it becomes 1. Each count is giving 1 microsecond. So required, you will generate how many counts are required. Then you will try to generate the desired count to be loaded in our registers using this formula. But remember one thing, you have to take 65,535. Okay. Then you will go to our main program. Okay. Generate, write a delay program here. So in that delay program, what you need to remember, you need to initialize TMOD register. Okay. Second thing, load the count in TL and TH, or TL1 and TH1. It's up to you. And in TCON, what you need to do, you need to start the counter. Okay. Then it has, the timer has to start the count. It has started the count here, but you need to wait until the count is completed. So for that, you have written this loop. Okay. And for the next time, okay, if the programmer is using this same system for the next time, so initially the TCON registers bits are already set. So to avoid that confusion, we are clearing these two bits. Okay. Okay, if you have any doubts, please message me. Okay, because I'm shifting to next topic, serial port topic. Okay. Okay, sorry for the disturbance. Okay, if you don't have any doubts in this thing, that is well and good. So I'm starting serial port. Okay. So what you can expect in this serial port? So before starting this, I simply want to differentiate between serial communication and parallel communication. So what is serial communication? You are transmitting bit by bit data through a single line. Okay, that is what serial communication. So what is the disadvantage here? It is slow because it is transmitting each bit at a time. Okay, coming to parallel communication, what happens, sir? You are able to transmit 8 bits at a time. So speed is more in parallel communication, but parallel communication has disadvantage as well as serial has disadvantage. So based, and they have advantages as well. If you want to transmit up to 100 kilometers your data, if you want to transmit to a very long distance, so you can't prefer parallel because cost will increase. So the best communication for long distance is what? Serial communication. If it is short distance and speed is important, you will definitely prefer parallel communication. But in our 8051, how we are dealing with this serial communication? So for serial communication, we are using this port, serial port. Okay, what is happening here? See. So here is a diagram. I have taken this diagram. In this, you are having 8-bit microprocessor and you are having SBUF register. That is what? Serial buffer register. Okay. Now there are two methods to transmit data. Suppose I am interested to transmit this number. What is this? 0010 and 0101. That is 25. If I am interested to transmit 25 to some external register or external device, I have two methods. First is using parallel communication, second is serial communication. So move P gamma hash 25H. What happens in one cycle? Okay, in using one cycle, this content will be loaded in P1 and that is taken by the external device. But coming to this, move SBUF comma hash 25, what happens? You are loading the data into this SBUF serial buffer register. But now from here, you need to transmit the data bit by bit. That means if 8 bits are available, you need 8 cycles. You need 8 cycles to transmit this data. So that is a big waste of time for us. So we don't want that thing to happen. So for that reason, what we will do, we will use this register, serial buffer register. So internally it is acting as parallel to serial register, shift register. Okay, parallel to serial shift register. Now what the processor will do, in one cycle, using one cycle, it will collect the 8-bit data and move that data into this SBUF using this instruction, move SBUF comma hash 25. Okay, the content is loaded here. See what is available here, 0010 to 0101, 25 is available here. Now it's the headache of this serial buffer register. Okay, it's a headache of the serial buffer register to convert this parallel data to serial and transmit bit by bit. Now our processor is free. Okay, if you are not using the serial buffer register, it becomes the headache of our processor to transmit bit by bit using 8 cycles. For 8 cycles, it is busy with only this 25 data. So to avoid that, we are using serial buffer register. Internally, it is what? A parallel to serial shift register. In one cycle, it will transmit the data and it will be free and it will work. It will do other operations. Now, what it will do, this serial buffer will convert parallel to serial and transmit data in 8 cycles. But we are not interested that it is taking 8 cycles or 100 cycles. So we are interested in our processor. It should be free to do other tasks. Okay. Now, suppose Now what is happening, see here. Now this 25 will move out. How it will be given to the external data? First LSB bit, what is this LSB bit? 1, I have given, indicated here with tick mark. So this LSB bit comes out and given to serial device, and last bit to be received by the serial device is what? 0. Okay. Now, if the serial device is transmitting data and we are supposed to receive the data, how we will receive the data? Same thing. So this is once again 25, 0010 and 0101. This is once again 25. But LSB bit is what? This one, and this is your MSB bit. Okay. So before going to reception, we will see how the transmission happens. Now, if you want to transmit only 25, what you will do? You will write this instruction, and after that processor becomes free and it will perform operation. But if I'm interested to transmit continuous data, 25, 30, 31, okay, some continuous, some 4-5 numbers, so then what should happen, sir? After transmitting this, okay, can I immediately write here move sbuf comma hash 30? No, I can't write this, because in one cycle it will be transmitting, loading this sbuf, it will be loading this sbuf with 25. But if immediately you write 30, what will happen? This processor will load sbuf with 30. So this data, it may be transmitted or it may not be transmitted. So immediately what happens, this 25 data will be overwritten by 30. So to avoid that thing, what we need to do, we need to see that this sbuffer is free or it is empty. Okay, for that also, every time the processor has to check here, okay, before transmitting 30, it has to see, okay, are you free? No, it is not free. So once again, after some seconds, once again it will verify, are you free? No. So this should happen. So every time this processor is verifying the condition of our sbuf, it is wasting its time. It is busy only by verifying it is free or not. So instead of that, what should happen, sir? Processor should do its own work. But after completion of transmission serially, this data, this buffer register has to inform the processor and interrupt. How it will inform? It will generate an interrupt and say the data what you have sent has been transmitted to serial device. So please send the next data. Then it will send the data. So in this fashion, our processor will be free to do other operations and serial buffer register is doing its own work. So how it will happen? See, so after this data has been completely transmitted to serial device, then there is a flag called TI flag is available, transmission interrupt. So this flag becomes 1 and immediately sbuf will interrupt our processor. Okay, then processor will send next data 30. After transmission of that 30, once again TI will become 1, interrupts the processor. It will take place continuously, this thing happens. See here, I have explained the same part diagrammatically. So first, what happened? You have loaded 25 in sbuf and sbuf is transmitting the data. Okay, the 25 data has been transmitted. Then what will happen? TI becomes 1, immediately interrupt is generated and it will disturb the processor. So when processor is disturbed, what will happen? It will service the interrupt. It will move to this ISR, and what it will do? Move sbuf comma A. Now A is having what? 30. Next data, 30 is available. So what will happen? This 30 will be loaded into sbuf, and while coming down, it is clearing this TI. Okay, clear TI bit. So what is happening, sir? In our previous class, we have seen TF0 and TF1. They are auto cleared. Okay, they are auto clear bits. But this TI is not an auto clear bit. So for that reason, we need to write clear TI. Then you will come back and see that no interrupt is available. You will continue with your normal programming. Is it clear? If you have not cleared this part, what will happen after coming to this? Once again, you see that TI is 1. You will see interrupt has generated one more time, and you will shift to this ISR. To avoid that thing, after serving this, loading next data, that is 30, into sbuf, before returning, what I will do, I will clear this TI and I will come back to this original position and continue normal execution. I think this part is very, very clear. Transmission part. Okay. Now coming to reception part. How you will receive the data? suppose the transmit, suppose the sender, some serial device has sent 25. So once again, you will receive the LSB bit first. Okay, then you will receive the MSB bit first. And that data will be taken into SBUF register. Now, you want that data immediately to be taken into our microprocessor. Okay, you have got 25 here. So you want this thing immediately to be taken. Okay, no, you don't want this data immediately taken into our processor. What you need to verify, you want to verify that what the data available, this data is valid data or not. So how to determine valid data or not using start bit and stop bit. So I will explain in the next slide, next slide. Consider this data is invalid. This data is invalid. Okay, so it has received some wrong stop bits and start bits. So basically we concentrate on stop bit. So standard is what? Start bit should be 0, stop bit should be 1. This is standard. So I will verify stop bit. If stop bit is 1, I will consider it is valid data. Okay, if stop bit is 0, I will consider that data as invalid. So when the data is invalid, should I load that into our processor? No. Okay, it won't load the data. So the sender or serial device will send the same data. What will happen here? So this previous data, invalid data is available, that will be overwritten by some valid data. Now second time you have received some data and the stop bit is 1. So what you will understand, okay, this data is valid data, and then RI bit will set. So RI is a flag here. Once again, interrupt reception means it is this flag will set. When this flag is set, you will interrupt the processor and you will inform that some valid data is available. Are you ready to accept? Then what should happen? It should go to the ISR and take the contents. So for that, see, once again, you see this part, I will explain with the ISR diagram. Suppose you have received this data, LSB first and MSB next, last. So here you have loaded this data, you will, this SBUF will verify using stop bit. If stop bit is 1, that is valid data. If it is not, it becomes invalid, it won't transmit to processor. Second data has been received. If it is valid, that will overwrite invalid data. Okay. If it is valid data is available, RI flag will be set to 1 and SBUF will interrupt the flag, interrupt the processor. Okay. Now, after the interrupting, what should happen? See here. Now, RI has set means you have valid data. So you have generated interrupt to the processor. It was working here. Because of this interrupt, it will go to ISR, interrupt service routine program. What should happen in this program, sir? SBUF has some valid data that has to be loaded into A. This thing should happen. Okay. After that, before moving to this position, you will clear this RI, because PAI and RI are the flags. They are not auto cleared. Okay. We need to clear those things. So for that reason, what I will write the instruction, clear RI, and I will return to this position and I will continue my normal programming. Is it clear? Now, the important register is SCON register, that is what, serial control register. So I will start from right hand side. Once again, it is a 8-bit register, TI and RI. So now itself you have seen RI and TI. See, RI, when it will become 1, sir, when some valid data is available in SBUF, then RI becomes 1. Okay, see here I have written the same. Becomes 1 when valid and complete data is received. Okay, second thing, TI, when it becomes 1, sir, we have seen already. So TI becomes 1 when the complete data has been transmitted. Okay, when complete data has been transmitted, it will interrupt the processor saying that you please send next data. Okay, now you see this blue ink, bit REN, so receiver enable, that is if you set this bit as 1, you will receive the data. If you are not interested in receiving the data, you will simply make it 0. That means you transmission is, it is up to you. Whenever you want to transmit, you are ready, processor is ready, it will load the data. But processor is busy with some important work, it don't want the interrupts from receiver. Then what it will do, simply it will disable receiver using this bit REN. If it is 0, it becomes disabled. Clear with that? Now, SM0 and SM1. So simply they are what? Modes. So once again, using the combination 00, 01 up to 11, you are selecting mode 0, mode 1, mode 2, and mode 3. So what are these three modes? We will see. Okay, for understanding, I have drawn here the modes. Okay, simply you can understand. So in these modes, okay, mode 0. So it is acting as a shift register. That means it will store 8-bit data. D8 means 8-bit data. And mode 1 is what? 8-bit UART mode. UART means universal asynchronous receiver transmitter. Okay. What is this, sir? UART means simply you can blindly believe this thing. Okay. Data which is preceded and succeeded by 2 bits. So here it should have start bit and it should have stop bit. So any data, okay, any data which is given a structure of a packet, like it is having start bit, data, and stop bit, then that procedure is called UART concept. Okay, that is UART. Okay, you are using 8 bit, so that means this D8 bit. Okay, you are transmitting 8-bit data, so it is called 8-bit UART. Okay, that is what mode 1. Now there is an interesting thing, 9-bit UART. Okay, so this is valid for mode 2 and mode 3. There you will be using start bit, 8 data bits, and 9th bit, which is a programmable bit, and then you will be using what? Stop bit. That means in between stop bit and start bit, you are having 9 bits. So because of that thing, what I'm mentioning, 9-bit UART. UART means data followed. So data is available in between start bit and stop bit. That is fixed. So how many bits are available? It will decide it is mode 1, that is what, 8-bit UART, or mode 2 or mode 3. If you are having 9 bits in between start bit and stop bit, that becomes 9-bit UART. Okay. Now see this thing. 9 bit means this extra 9th bit what we are taking in mode 2 and mode 3, that 9th bit is programmable. So this programmable bit is having very important significance, very important, which is very, very important in modern day lives. So I will explain how it is important. Okay. So before that, you can see these bits, TB 8 bit and RB 8 bit. TB 8 bit means, okay, transmission bit. Okay, the name is what? 9th bit to be transmitted. You are considering this bit for 9th bit to be transmitted, which is available in mode 2 and mode 3. Okay, RB 8, that is what? 9th bit to be transmitted, valid for mode 1, mode 2, and mode 3. Okay, so here you have seen this particular 9th bit. Okay, this particular 9th bit. If it is 0, what will happen? If it is 1, what will happen? I will explain in detail. Okay, so basically this TB8 and RB8, that two things are concentrating or worried about 9th bit of transmission. Okay, that means this TB8 will be transmitted, it will be received. Now coming to next bit, SM2. SM2 means it will enable multiprocessor communication. Okay, multiprocessor communication means, what do you understand from multiprocessor? In 8086, we have seen maximum mode. That means there you have more than one processor. In a similar way, here also you will be using more than one processor. See, for broadcasting, you need more than one processors. Broadcasting means, you can take the example of TV. It is what it comes under broadcasting. That means one transmitter and many receivers. That is what broadcasting. Okay. Selective transmission means one transmitter, a few selected receivers. So that is what selective transmission. So broadcasting means as the number of users are increasing, so it becomes burden to a single processor. Okay. To avoid that burden, what we will do? We will use more number of processors. That is what SM2. That is what indicated by SM2. It is enabling multiprocessor communication system. So here you can see these numbers. One, it is indicating M2 and M3. So it is not one. You have taken the serial numbers, not 1, 2, 3. If it is 1 or 2, simply they are for after enabling this communication system, so what will happen to mode 2 and mode 3? What will happen to mode 1? What will happen in mode 0? So SM2 means, okay, SM2 means in this particular mode, you are making your receiver to check the data. Okay, now with this bit, what will happen if SM2 bit is 1? See, if receiver bit SM2 bit is 1, what will happen, sir? Okay, SM2 bit is 1, then this receiver part SBUF here, it will verify the data. Okay, definitely it will verify the data before giving to microprocessor. So if you are interested to verify the data, check the data, then you should make SM2 bit equal to 1. Suppose you are not interested in checking the data, whatever is received, so I want to transmit that thing, simply I will mention SM2 bit to 0. But okay, there is a difference between REN means if you are interested, if the processor is not interested in this data or disturbance from SBUF, it will make REN 0. Here, you want receiver, make REN equal to 1. You don't want receiver to disturb you, make REN 0. That's one thing. Second thing is that you are interested in receiving data, but you are interested to receive only valid data. So that means you are interested in checking. So then you will issue what SM2 equal to 1. Okay? If you are not interested in data, so you want whatever coming SBUF, you want to take that thing. SM2 equal to 0. See, clear? Simply, REN means you are enabling receiver or disabling receiver. Okay. After enabling receiver, you are interested in two things once again. You want valid data or any data. That's up to you. If you want only valid data, what you will mention, sir? SM2 equal to 1. If you want any data, then what you will mention? You will mention SM2 equal to 0. Okay. Now, what is happening, okay, how to understand this thing, okay, I will take this thing. See, if you are receiving this data, 8-bit data, you have any stop bit or you have start bit or stop bit? No, you don't have any start bit and stop bit. So can you verify this data is valid or invalid? No, you can't verify. So in mode 1, simply you will receive the data. You are not interested in valid or invalid data because you can't perform, you can't check this data is valid or not, okay. I am sending 25. I know what I am sending as 25, but you as a receiver, you don't know what is the data. Okay, so you can't decide that data is valid or invalid. Simply you can decide the validity of data based on stop bit. Okay. So here in mode 0, okay, there is no chance of verification or checking. So that means what I can say, SM2 bit is not valid for mode 0. Hence what I mentioned, in mode 0, this SM2 bit is not used. Is it clear? Now coming to next thing, in mode 1, okay, you have start bit and you have stop bit, so it is a standard. Blindly you can believe this thing, 0 is a start bit, 1 is a stop bit. That means now you have received the data. Okay, now you have received the data. Okay, suppose you have received 25. So how you will receive, sir? So before this 25, you will be having 0. That is what your start bit. And after this MSB bit, you will be having 1. Okay. After receiving the data, you will verify stop bit. If stop bit is 1, your data is valid. If stop bit is 0, your data is invalid. That is, you need to believe. Okay. It will verify only the stop bit. Clear? Now, why, sir, you may get the doubt, sir. Can't I verify start bit? So how you can, after receiving the data, you will verify it is valid or invalid. But before receiving the data, if you are saying that it is valid or invalid, that becomes a wrong decision. So you should take the data first and then you need to decide. So because of that reason, I am giving importance to stop bit. Okay, I will receive the data and then verify, okay, stop bit is 1, okay, it is valid. If it is not, it is invalid. Clear with that? Now, so we were in mode 1. Okay, here in mode 1, if every time there is a possibility that you can verify the validity of data. If this stop bit is 1 every time you are receiving the data, then that means what? You are receiving valid data. Okay. So in this mode 2, sorry, in this mode 1, SM2 has importance. Yes, definitely it has importance. So when you have, when you are selecting this mode 1, definitely you should see that SM2 bit. It's up to you. You may select as SM2 as 1 or 0. So in general, we prefer SM2 as 1 for mode 1. Okay. Now, coming to this third thing, mode 2 and 3. So you are using this 9th bit. Okay. Here it becomes very important. Okay. So you may say, sir, sir, simply you are increasing the number of bits. So what is the reason, sir? You have, once again, you are sending stop bit. That means I am making the receiver to believe that, see, I am making the receiver to believe that what the data I have sent is valid or invalid. So it's up to me as a transmitter. I am making sure that what the data I have sent to that particular receiver, purposefully I may write 0 here. So it will, so what the receiver will understand, it won't think it is having 9 bits here. Simply it will understand what receiver will verify 0. It will take data and then it will verify what is the last bit. So it won't consider this bit. Okay, this bit will be available, but after data, immediately what the bit is available, receiver will understand that is what my stop bit. So it will verify. If it is 0, it will understand it, this D8 or 8 bit data is invalid. If it is 1, it is valid. So as a programmer, we can program this bit to 0 or 1. Why, sir, how it becomes important? So to explain the importance of this thing, I will take the example of your TV cable. So in your modern day, you are aware that you have paid channels. That means you select a package. That means you want only some Telugu channels and you don't want Hindi channels. Suppose you don't want other channels, what you are not interested. Okay, then what you will do, based on your package, you will pay. Suppose you have interested only in some 5 Telugu channels, you will pay some 500 rupees for that. Consider, I am taking a rough figure. You are paying only 500 for those 5 channels, but there are 20 channels available. Okay, if you want all those 20 channels, you need to pay some 1500. Okay, it's up to you, but okay, it's up to you. If you are paying 500 rupees, you will get only 5 channels. If you are paying 1500 rupees, you are getting all 20 channels. Now you will see that TV cable, okay, TV cable is connected to a colony. Okay, and then you will have splitters. Okay, it will main cable will be connected to one thing. You have splitters. From those splitters, 8 different connections will come out. That means the same thing is given to 8 different homes. Okay, now one person, consider one person has subscribed. Okay, he has selected which package? Only 5 Telugu channels package. So he will pay 500 rupees. Okay. Immediately neighbor. Okay. Second person. I will take person 1, person 2. Okay. Person 1 has selected the package of only Telugu channels. Second person has selected the all channels. Selected all channels. He had paid 1500 rupees. But now the problem is that serial cable, that cable has all the channels available. So what are channels, sir? They are simply like 8 bits. They are simply like 8 bit data. Okay. For understanding, you understand this part. So this 8 bit data is nothing but your channel. So which has 0 and 1. Okay. But two people, person 1 and person 2, definitely they will receive all the channels, because on your cable you have all the channels. So how you will differentiate? Person 1 should receive only selected channels and person 2 should receive all the channels. So to explain this, you people have seen your setup box. Okay, in that setup box, a person, okay, the cable guy, he will come and he will insert a smart card. Okay, he will swipe a card or simply he will insert the card. So based on that card, you will decide what will happen. Okay, so you have select, that person will select a normal card, okay, card 1. Once again, I'm differentiating the card. If he is inserting or swiping normal card into the set of box, so what will happen? for first person, person one, he has, by swiping that set of box, he has made SM2 bit as 1, okay? By swiping that card or inserting the card 1, he has made that set of box as set of box SM2 bit as 1. So internally, that set of box will be having microcontroller. Internally, you will be having this SCON register. So by inserting smart card, you will make this SM2 bit as 1, okay? So what if SM2 becomes 1? If SM2 is 1 means you are verifying the data before transmitting to processor. Before transmitting the data to TV, you will, the set-top box will verify the validity of data. So how, what will happen, sir? You are having all 20 channels. So for all the 20 channels, okay, as a cable person, what I will do for all the 20 channels, I may set 1 or I may set 0. So what I will do, what the 5 channels you have selected, for that I will mention this 9th bit as 1, okay, for your cable connection. And for all other 15 channels, I will set this as 0. Now the setup box will receive these channels, all channels, it will receive all channels. But what it will do, sir, if it has received a data with ending with 1, okay, he will understand this is valid data, Telugu channel, and he will transmit it to TV, okay? So for 5 Telugu channels, I will set this 9th bit as 1. And what I need to do, sir, you should not get remaining 15 channels. So for remaining 15 channels, what I will do, I will make this 9th bit as 0. So that setup box will simply verify this last bit, this 9th bit. If it is 1, Telugu channel transmitted. Other channel, you have not paid for that, it won't be given to TV. Is it simple? Is it clear? No. Person of second home, second person, he will take second card. Card will be different, sir, once again. So second card, using that, by inserting that second card in your set-top box, what he will do, sir, he will simply make this SM2 as 0. SM2 is 0 means you are not interested in checking the data. What it will do, simply whatever the data you got, you will simply, you will get, you will, whatever the data is received by the SBuffer, simply that data will be transmitted to microprocessor in our technical diagram. Coming to our example is what? So serial cable will be having all channels. So second card is inserted in setup box of person 2. That means by inserting that card, I have made SM2 equal to 0. That means setup box won't verify which channel is available. Okay. Simply what he will do, he will simply throw the channels, whatever the channels you have received, simply it will throw onto your TV. Now, what you have done by selecting this SM2 as 0 means, what will happen? This 9th bit has become 1 for all. So when the setup box receives a Telugu channel, he will transmit to TV. If he is receiving some other channel, okay, some sports channel, so by default for all the channels you have selected 1. So simply all the channels will be given to our TV. So in this fashion, you are differentiating a paid person, okay, paid customer to unpaid customer. Okay, some free channels are also available. Free channels means DD National and some other channels are free. So even if you have not paid anything, you will get those free channels. So for those free channels, what we need to do, we need to make this 9th bit as 1. So using these things, you can control your broadcasting. Okay, TV is the example of your broadcasting. To control the paid channels, okay, you can use this method. Is it clear? Okay, the same thing I have written here. Okay, we don't have 9th bit in our mode 0. So here, what will happen, sir? We are not interested in SM2. Okay, coming to this thing, second is what? Number 2. Okay, number 2 is about M1. Now what is happening with M1? If SM2 is selected as 1, then what will happen? RI will become 1. If stop bit is 1, stop bit is 1 means, see one thing, SM2 equal to 1 means you are ready to verify the validity of data. First thing, okay? Now what will happen, sir? If you have got stop bit as 1, that means it's valid data, then RI will become 1 and interrupt the processor. Second condition, if stop bit is 0, then what will happen, sir? It is invalid data, so RI won't become 1. Clear? No interrupt? nothing. In mode 2 and mode 3, what we will do is SM2 equal to 1, okay, by selecting this programming bit. So it's up to us. I have taken the example of TV cable. So if you want to supply all the channels to a paid subscriber who has paid 1500, all channels means purposefully I will program this 9th bit to 1. And second part, okay, person 1 has selected only 5 channels. For those 5 channels, I will make stop bit as 1. And for all the remaining, the 9th bit programmable bit will become 0. Clear with this? So I hope you have understood this part. And if you have any doubts, please ask. With this, our session ends. Okay. See, if you have any doubts, please ask. Students, are you listening? See, one more thing. Your CR has informed that you have class from 11. Okay, so if you have doubts, what you do, you message me in WhatsApp so that I can answer you. Okay. And one more thing, see, if any other faculty is ready to take class from 11, you inform that particular faculty that already RF sir is taking classes regularly from 11 a.m. So you please change your timings. So every time some person is ready to take the class, I can't change my class timings. So, okay. So it's better that CRs take the responsibility, inform other faculty that Arif sir is taking continuously and he will stick with that timing 11 to 12. So please change your timings as per your suitability, okay? Asking them to do that thing, okay? See, if you have any doubts, please message me in WhatsApp, our group is available. I'm ending this session, okay? Thank you.